Hi, good afternoon. Is this good? Okay. I can see that people are hungry and they want to consume, but we are going to talk about just the opposite. How is it that we reduce our consumption? I'm not asking you to skip lunch, but I'm just saying one of the things that we've been talking in the last decade is about how humans are eating up the planet, and how is it that we now need to have strategies to come together and save the world. And there could be no three better people with, you know, bubbling with ideas than the people I have on stage. Nitin Sethi, as you know, is a leading investigative journalist, has written on environment and corporate issues. Prerna Bindra, possibly the finest young writer we have on conservation related issues, and Richard Mahapatra, who's followed development, environment, and rural sector more intently than anybody I know. So I'm going to give them 3 minutes each to give their pitch on what they think needs to be done. I mean, one big ask, if there was to be made in terms of policy and in terms of behavioral change, what is it that you need to do to save the planet? So let's start with you, Nitin.
Hi, thank you for having your patience in being here and dropping your lunch or delaying it at least. I think what the question you're asking is, how do we save the planet for ourselves? Because if we took away human society, then the rest would perhaps continue to be in a different way. To my mind, I think a simple task that we've not been able to do as a human society, and that's integral to saving the planet, is to, in our social systems, we've talked about, whether we are democratic nations or otherwise, of notions of equality. I think if we can now progress towards also looking at notions of equity, that itself would perhaps be the greatest impediment to destruction. It would perhaps, if not inordinately stop, but inordinately delay the processes that we are going through, where a certain segment of society consumes most and makes the other, the poorer sections, suffer more. I think when we speak and imagine nature and preservation and conservation of nature, if we turned around from the notion of pure conservation to a notion of saying how there's a more equitable use of these natural resources by different contesting parties, and conservation I see as one of the contesting parties. If we were able to turn the society around and say, how do we constantly, in every policy process that we make, every decision that as a society, as a community level we make, that equity becomes a basis of using resources, we would be moving away, I think, from the kind of destructive paths that growth has taken in the previous, in the name of the poor, but largely for a small segment of more powerful vested interests.
Right, so Nitin, I mean, there's a point of departure, I think, in the previous session as well, when you were speaking with Madhav Gadgil, you had a similar question for him, and my question to you would be that this is typically the answer that you hear from an economist, that, you know, let's get a more equitable society, and, you know, distribution of wealth and distribution of resource is something that is going to address the long-term needs of the planet. I'm not sure whether that's ever going to happen, because some of us are more greedy than the others. Some of us will always have more power than the others. And so I think those kind of discriminations, given that they will exist in every human's lifetime, I think is an impossible task. So I'm now going to ask Prerna that, you know, what is her mantra for solving the world's problems?
I wish we could solve the world's problem in this 1 hour skipping lunch session that is there. But it's... tall order. I would like to twist that thing. I don't think we are saving the planet. It's about saving ourselves. It's the planet saving us. Like when you say save the tiger or save the, you know, Gangetic River dolphin or save the water bird, waterfall or save the vulture, it's not about the species. Yes, it is about the species, because you know, we do have a shared earth, and all of us do have an equal right to this planet. But leaving that ethical reasons apart, I mean, I think we need to draw the links between how the loss of a vulture, we have lost 97 to 99% of some of our vulture species. How that has, because vultures were a very efficient scavenger, because they used to scavenge off carcasses which were, you know, thrown, dumped on the road, dumped in fields, dumped wherever. It was a very efficient disposal system. And with the dramatic and sudden decline, we have had dogs come in who are not efficient scavengers, the bodies are left, and we have a national health emergency. Zoonotic diseases have spread, which you know is more up your street, and we have a spike in rabies cases. So every species like that, the loss of a species, we don't know the impacts that are going to be there. When, what does the dolphin need to survive? It needs unpolluted waters, it needs clear streams, you know, and that is what we also need. So if it is a problem of solving the air pollution problem in India's capital, it's not about, oh, we are saving the environment, we are saving our children. I think, and just 1 minute I'll take, taking off from Nitin's thing, where he very rightly speaks that equity needs to be at the center and factored in all policy. I would say environment and conservation issues need to be factored, and this is my ask of policy, need to be factored in, whether it's a mining decision, whether it's a highway decision, whether it's, I mean, if we plan, incorporate this during the planning stage, before you slice through a 6-lane highway through the fragile Western Ghats, and you know, then there will be landslides like we saw a year or two back. It needs to be factored in. Everything has an ecological impact.
So I think you are, you have a point of departure from what Nitin is saying, because Nitin's saying that, you know, that road needs to reach every village in order to reach, you know, to reach every household or community. I mean, need not be a 6-lane highway, it could be a single metal road, but nevertheless it has to reach, right? Now this is where, I mean, the question to my mind is, Nitin provides an economist's argument. I think you are trying to say, in a sense, that, you know, there is a proportion of which, you know, of a land mass that needs to be kept aside for conservation. And something that Madhav Gadgil was talking about this morning, and later Kasturi Rangan's report also said, but reduce that number. But my question is it all math? I don't agree with it. I mean, is it all about math?
But I think, give you a nuanced reply, yeah, later when I,
yes,
speak.
Yes, absolutely. And I'm now going to ask Richard for his pitch.
If you just, I think the first fact is that ecosystem per se doesn't respect the rules, regulations, or the consumption patterns set by us. You know, we as humans, I think, overtaken almost, it's like a coup on the natural ecosystems. And we believe that by exploiting and by using, we are actually bringing out a great economic prosperity. But like both of them, they said, we don't actually need to save the planet per se, saving it for some cosmetic values. The, you know, the ecosystem is the economy for Indians, and for that matter, 5 billion people who survive on ecologically degraded areas, it's the economy for them. Now look at it. The carbon concentration currently in the atmosphere was the highest since 5 million years. 50 lakh years, we never saw this kind of carbon concentration in the atmosphere. And what does it mean? I think when we had that point of time, the human was not there. It was just a natural way of warming, or the sea level was still, you know, 10 meters higher. Calicut probably was under sea that point of time. So most of the subcontinent, and the earth was warmer by 2 to 3 degrees, and we were not there. And in this brief period of 200 years to 300 years, we have created a situation that this planet never saw it, so never witnessed it.
Give us your pitch. What is it?
Yeah,
that you're
my pitch is that when you come to that, we need to talk a bit about the role of humans or the Anthropocene, the age of Anthropocene. And the second is that we need to debate on these conjunctions. Conjunction debate also sometimes get, you know, again polarized. The best example now, you must have seen it, is that, you know, vegetarianism. As if going vegetarian is the only way of solving the conjunction side. We actually don't talk about the conjunctions in totality. What to consume, how to consume, and how the produce are consumed. I think that's we need to talk a bit more about.
Okay, so I think you make a very fair point. I don't think the answer therefore lies in one solution. It can't be being vegan or vegetarian or non-meat eater or whatever, or degrading the deep, causing the deforestation in the Amazon to, or the palm oil in Indonesia. I think the answers are elsewhere. But I think I would also have a point of departure with you, because looking at, you know, the Anthropocene by itself, and you yourself say that, I mean, carbon has increased, you know, not since 5 million years ago. The difference, what was happening, 5 million years ago, slightly more than 5 million years ago, that the Asian monsoon was forming, and the reason why carbon was at its peak was because the Antarctic ice shelf had not formed, and the monsoons hadn't formed also. I mean, the Australian, the East African, and the Asian monsoons hadn't formed. And with the formation of these monsoons, you had greater sedimentation, and of course, there's a geological cycle. The problem that we have now is adding carbon without having a solution to burying that carbon. Because earlier, the challenge was not because more carbon was being added or getting submerged. The challenge that we have now is that we started taking petrochemicals and coal from the belly of the earth, and we release it up, which has been stayed buried for millions of years. And we're not packing back that carbon deep from where we have taken it out. The challenge is that, because even if you were to green, and I'm going to break Prerna's heart here, that, you know, even if you were to green the entire planet, it's still not going to solve your carbon crisis. Your carbon crisis is on the surface, because like the Australian wildfire, that's going to happen, and again, you will not have a solution to trap that carbon. The only solution which I see, and I'm being trying to preemptively provoke you, is that it's not largely in inequities. It's not only in the conservation or in the consumer part, but it's also in fraudulent science. And this fraud in science just now, especially in the IPCC, is this, that nobody wants to bring in geologists or oceanographers to talk about how to bury carbon that you've taken from the depth of the earth and put it back, because nobody wants to talk about geoengineering. So my question to Nitin now is that, you know, if you're going to talk about inequity and you're going to talk about technology, because I think in the last 50 years, I think there's been an over-reliance on technology, and saying that, you know, we might have a technological solution to this problem, so we can wait, you know, we can push it to the brink and we'll have a technological breakthrough, right? So I'm going to ask Nitin that, you know, how long are we going to therefore wait for that brinkmanship to happen each time, and then, you know, have something that will save us?
So I think you touched upon two or three different paths, and both fascinating. You could go in either direction and have complex conversations. One is when you were referring to Prerna's, and you were referring to, I think, in a bad tone, she never said that you need forest to save climate change. She said you need forest for the forest's sake, and you can do other things also. I don't think the question right now before global society, countries, when they come together, is whether we have enough technologies to resolve the climate change problem. I think there is complete agreement that there are technologies available. With current set of technologies, even at perhaps current rates and prices of technologies, it's possible to solve the climate change problem, not the
conserving the nature problem, but the climate change emissions problem. The challenge is that those technologies sit in certain corners of the world. Those corners who've enjoyed the fruits of this development. How do you again distribute these technologies, get them adapted in the countries which are going to get impacted, and make sure countries like India do not go down the same path that Europe and global north has? Again, to me, this is why, and therefore I wanted to nuance my first statement. The answer is not in just having those set of technologies, but the route that you take to reach those technologies and spread them. And the route to reach those technologies and make those technologies come to every corner that they are required in is equity. Now, if you had the principle of equity, it does not say every village has a road. But then you say that if every village does not need to have the road like everyone else has had, what technologies are required to make sure the villages can do their lives, get better off, without having a road per square kilometer? Maybe having kacha roads works better for villages than having tarred roads that trucks go on and build more dams on. But the route to achieving that formula is embedded in the principle of equity. The moment you accept that, as Richard was saying, and she also refers to, the moment you accept there's been inequity and you want to resolve that, is not to say that I will do the same nonsense that you did, but I will say you've enriched yourself from this nonsense. Now part with a little bit of that to us to allow us to do it differently. Now, I would presume that in due time, India would end up stabilizing its emissions by 2030, 35. At that time, India would also say, look, we are like anyone else now. Therefore, we all need to act together. If you want even a lazy Indian government to do more, perhaps globally you need to say, okay, all we are asking is accelerate what you're doing. Don't go down the same path, and don't go down the path of sustainability over 30 years, do it over 10 years, because we are reaching a precipice. Now, again, the argument would be that we are not going to do exactly what you want, but you've amassed enough wealth, and that is what colonialism was about in one place, is to say part with a little bit of that in terms of technology, finance, abilities, capacities, hand it over not even to India, but to Africa. I think Africa is going to be the continent that bears the brunt of China and India growing. We will colonize certain parts of Africa. We have already begun to do that. Now, if we need to not do that and not grow the way Europe has, and I think Madhav was using a silly argument of having Norway. Norway has a history of colonialism that ensured it is rich enough today to take care of its own citizens. We can't do that because we perhaps will do it with Africa, but what will the Africans do then? So if you embed the principle of equity inside and say, look, where do we need distribution of technology and resources to enable those who have not done any wrong to survive the changes that are going to happen, do the transitions faster and not slower?
I'm just going to provoke you a little more and say that, you know, I mean, I agree with your economic construct of equity, I mean, of distribution of technology, and that, you know, the transfer of benefits should go to Africa or to small island nations. But the question is that in the current economic paradigm, you've got crony capitalism at one level, and you've got future commitments to corporates that are so binding, and you've got a frail economic system in terms of banks and lending. All these, I mean, economics by itself is a notional construct, right? I mean, the concept of money is notional. The only reality we know is nature. And we try putting a dollar value on that nature, which is also a human-induced value, to which we don't know the services of creatures, of ecosystems and rivers. How is it that such a flawed economic, ecologic valuation is something based on assuming that technology is going to answer it, is something that I have no comprehension of? And I think even if we had comprehension, there would be people like what's happening in the IPCC or what happened in University of East Anglia in terms of the climate gate issue is precisely the kind of thing that's going to happen.
So I would, I don't think it's about economics. It's about ethics and morality. Economics is a social construct, as you rightly say. Economics existed before money and currency existed. We had sequestering of natural resources by different communities as contestations without having money. if I were to claim that I need to preserve this part of land for nature, I am in some sense sequestering that resource away from some other communities, rightly or wrongly. Right? I am taking away their rights over that land because of my understanding of nature, it's an aesthetic understanding. Therefore, economic utilization of resources has always existed with or without money. What you're trying to perhaps do, and this is the argument that people present, is not about technology. It is about how do you therefore look at nature's appropriation differently. And as enough history proves, if this nature of appropriation is more equitous, it prevents exploitation by a few. Now, in practical terms, like you refer to the kind of politics we have and what it leads to, because our politicians are more endowed to, say, corporates than they are to us as citizens. In practical terms, it again means empowering the poor in a democracy, right? Making sure that politics is not funded by corporates, finding an electoral process which is funded by citizens. Why would I not make sure, say, having a law, considering, I mean, this is a pet topic for the last 6 months, we have electoral bonds where BJP government takes 4,000 crores from corporates and then says it's working for us. If you turned it around and said electoral politics will only work when citizens pay money to politicians, nobody else but a citizen can contribute to electoral politics, and that itself will bring a taming down, take out all these artificial entities that fund politics, like companies, corporates, NGOs, trusts. Only citizens fund politics, and they are the only ones that vote. There are ways to do this. Are we reaching an ideal? No. As you said, equity is an ideal that you cannot reach. But are we even aspiring for it right now? I don't think we are as an electoral democracy in India. We are actually going farther away, where we are disenfranchising citizens and some of the poorest and the most marginal. And I can tell you consequences of things like in, you know, NPR and citizenship, etc., is you will further marginalize those who are on the periphery of Indian society. You will make them victims, and these are the people who will then have an immediate physical pressure on resources, and then you'll start blaming them yet again. This is a history that we've repeated, say, with tribal communities across the nation, not only here, but in Europe and US. This is the tradition we've had with the Dalits. By taking them away from resources, we have made them look as if they are the ones physically exploiting it, but they've borne the brunt of nature not being appropriated more equitably.
I agree with you to a certain point, and again, our roads diverge, but I'm going to bring in Prerna and Richard here, because I think, you know, one of the things that, you know, we are looking at the planet, and let's be spacemen and spacewomen for a moment and start looking at the Earth of what's going wrong. You know, it's turning brown, the oceans are turning muddy, it's inkier, the life on it ceases to exist, we've got plastic islands, all those issues that we all know of. But the question is, who's doing what? And I would actually play the devil's advocate here and say, accuse the community which, say, Prerna represents, and say that, listen, in the past, you have agreed to barter for saying that, you know, we will agree to something like compensatory afforestation and things like that, which are now coming to bite back at you. And I think this particular state in particular has been one of those states which has agreed to forsake ecology and go for economics, whether it's in plantation crops, whether it's high dams, the three big dams that it has, or you know, rapid development, urbanization. I mean, one fact that I came to know about a couple of years ago was that Kerala actually imports sand from Vietnam because it has no sand of its own. You know, the rivers have been, you know, extracted completely because of two things. One, for construction, and two, wherever you had high monazite concentration, it was sent to China surreptitiously or to other countries like smuggling. So, you know, you have inherently created crises for yourself, and I'm not trying to point fingers only at Kerala, I'm just making a point here, that what have conservationists been doing, and have they been, you know, not been together on this, and have there been some compromises that should not have been made earlier?
I'm sorry, not together on?
With the corporate greed
issue. See, one is the community I represent, and just come back to that. Currently, the community I represent is wildlife. Yeah, and certainly, while the most marginalized in terms of so, where has conservation failed, or has conservationists failed, or whether you know corporate? It's complex. See, we are in the age of sixth extinction, right? We are, there was a report out, it did not make as much noise as IPCC, but the biodiversity, the UN biodiversity report, which says 1 million species are at risk. We have lost about 45% of our species, of our wildlife in the past 40 years. So in the space of my lifetime, we have lost over 40% of wildlife. So it's we are in a bad situation. There's so much to say. I'm not figuring out what is the, but I would also like to, when you say you would like to accuse the same community. You know, all of us are consumers, right? Some of us much more, and this issue of equity comes in. Let's look at the other side. I've just come back from Wayanad. And I have, for 10 days, I was with people who face the brunt of the animals that I strive to save, so many of us strive to save every day. There are elephants which are wiping out livelihoods overnight. There are elephants which are killing people. There are tigers which are killing people. I don't mean it, but the scale is still immense. And we are, you know, if you look at Europe, they won't tolerate any carnivore. We have a hell of a lot of tolerance that these animals are amongst us. Having said that, the animals are also bearing the brunt. Why are the animals doing this? So I've been to places in, say, Jharkhand, Orissa, where the communities tell me, madam, पहले तो पता ही नहीं चलता था हाथी आता था. The elephant would come and all they would see were its big, you know, prints on the ground. And they would, you know, they were the elephant, right? And they said, महाकाल गुस्सा कब हो गया? And then they say कि पर हमने उससे सब कुछ ले लिया, सब छीन लिया. Yeah, I'll translate. Why are the gods angry with us? They are angry because we have taken everything away from them, their home, their water, their everything. So they retaliate. And they're poisoned. I came across an elephant carcass just 2 months back, two days back, it had been poisoned. A gaur had been poisoned. So it's actually a war out there. And why is that happening? Because we are fragmenting the forest, because we are encroaching into the forest. What do you say to a tribal? Save that animal, but you know, you now don't know whether your child will be killed tomorrow by it. So, you know, the stories that you hear when you go there. So, how do you save wildlife in such situations? So again, yes, we do need spaces, and I know Nitin and I will go into a war if we are allowed to out here. We do need places where it has to be just wildlife, because elephants and tigers, incredible animals, engineers of the ecosystem, contribute to biodiversity of a forest, save your forest as much as the smallest being does, but they are not easy neighbors. They are dangerous neighbors. And the society, the tribal society, is also evolving. There are people who still wedded to the land, but there are people who want malls in their backyard. Do we deny them that? But can you take a mall into a protected area? Will the protected area remain? That is where our, you know, we perhaps conservationists don't agree on, and we have issues. But to me, the stakeholder here are two. One is the person who's living right next to the wildlife. What does he want? What does he, she want? What do they want for their children? They couldn't go to school because when they went to school, there were elephants on the way. So you had to keep them in a hostel. If you kept them in the hostel, they were, you know, problems. Girls' education could not progress because there were issues with the hostels. However, in Kerala especially, there are special hostels for such children. You know, these are, so they are the stakeholders. What do they want? They don't want that life for their children.
Just step in and ask.
And the wildlife, that's the second.
Okay, say, okay, yeah. So I think I want Nitin to respond very quickly on the two things that Prerna said. One is, of course, on the war that you would like to go on. But, you know, just respond very quickly on what her counter is.
Sure. Two things. So I think I mean, if I was to agree with Prerna's idea of sequestering certain lands for wildlife, I could actually would like to take that a scale higher. I would say we should sequester our lifestyles to save the planet. Therefore, after 4 p.m., all of us should shut off electricity. Our electricity footprints will go down. It'll actually do much more to save nature than keeping tigers and elephants away from tribals. Now, that said, theoretically, this is how far we are going then. And if you go that far, then it's fine with me. But if you do not go that far, then there's another way to do this. Is, I can promise, I mean, I'm an adopted child into an area where tribal communities live dangerously, not so dangerously with nature, and much more happily, and they do much more to protect, as she's rightly saying, than all of us trying to claim that we work for it, is the fact that if you ask them, do you want to preserve a certain piece of land for nature, most of them would say yes. But they would also say the cost, therefore, that we have to bear for doing this, you must at least somewhere compensate it for that. Now, the moment you get a notion of equity and democracy and equal rights for all citizens, you can tell a community, please leave this piece of land alone for certain other things. Maybe one, I as conservationist like to keep this, and I think I understand that this is valuable. Maybe you don't say it in the same fashion. I understand it's very valuable. You'll also learn if you get educated in the way that I have in rational science. But if the average tribal has an equal right as me and you, then she or he would say, therefore, if I still want a laptop and an urban life, how much would you need to compensate me for this? Because that money will then come out of my pocket. Right now, the model that we have of conservation, this is why it repeatedly fails while it's right, done for the right purposes. We don't want to give away anything from our pocket. Our lifestyles continue. While we say, oops, we did wrong, now you should not, so you kind of leave this land alone and we figure out what you do with your lives. Now, the moment that turns around and says, the Gram Sabha gets to decide, yes, we go in and say, look, I'm interested in keeping the space away from you. It will help you as everyone else. If you contest with the Gram Sabha and convince them, they can tell you how much resources they need to send their kids to universities like we went to do the same education, to be able to be as eloquent in these languages as they are in their own. You need to have democratic principles where every citizen is equal, and then do the exact thing that she wants to do. But if you subjugate democracy to set this up and short circuit democracy, you will have the kind of backlashes we get, where even the most tolerant societies at some point get angry and kill an elephant, where they're actually taking the revenge against the government, not the elephant. They're doing it out of anger.
Right, I think this is a metaphor. I mean, the elephant being a metaphor, it could be a river, it could be a hill, it could be anything, and it could be mining for granite. I'll come back to you, Prerna. I just want to bring in Richard just now, because what both of you touched on was on consumption. I know Richard has a very interesting perspective on consumption, and I think you need to tell us where is the departure, who should consume how much, and where is natural justice within this climate justice and the issue of equity.
See, the first thing, if you look at it, I think we started saying that we are saving the planet for ourselves. Let me remind you, when climate change debate was happening and the developed countries were saying climate change or the global warming was happening due to the animal gas. Methane. Methane is the technical name. In the parlance, the animals in developing countries are farting more, so that is precisely what is warming the atmosphere. Agriculture in the developing countries emitting more, so that is responsible. And amid that debates and discussions, there was something a former US president said, our lifestyle is not negotiable. Now come back to currently, 21st century. You know, 4% of people accounting for 60% of GDP. So what is the economy of that 96% of people that we must save when we are saving the planet? Let me get back into this consumption debate now. You know, average Indian, and for that matter, it's actually it's ecological, it's a gross nature, national product is actually not relevant to them. It gross nature produce. We all depend on biomass. So you can say that it's a biomass economy. Our poverty is ecological. So our consumption per se is not that kind of things. Now look at one after another. Now you say that it's energy consumption. Energy consumption, you know, even despite everything, we have close to 300 million people without access to clean energy in India. That's energy poverty. Now come to your pure consumption on the basis of goods and services that we do. It's 10% of total goods and services being consumed in India by hardly 2% of the people. Now look at the most debated one. You know, the way we eat food is going to actually decide how emission will take place and how it will take place and the impact on the planet. This is most debated one and being actually sold and being bought over by people also, bought in by people also. Now look at it. An Indian average consumes hardly, you know, 10 kilos in a best case scenario of non-veg. And an American, 10 times of that. The same thing. So it's nothing to do with, you know, our consumption. The consumption, who is consuming, how the food is produced. It's a completely industrial level of consumption that's actually pulling it down.
This is, you know, a little different. I'm saying when the entire earth is in peril, you know, a country like India cannot be like a bad student and say, oh, you got a bigger slice of the pie then, now I should be getting my bigger pie now. I mean, are you going to push the envelope so much further on the table that we come to, you know, because of our bickering, this whole debate of how to address the climate change problem or biodiversity crisis or the acidification of ocean or so many other things that we have, are we going to labor on this for so long? And I think every country, whether it's Malawi or any other small country, everybody has the right to ask the same question. And it might take another 2,000 years before all of these countries come to that level of US consumption. I mean, all you have to do is travel along this marine drive and you will see hoardings of, you know, realty companies and people trying to sell you homes. They're all called, you know, Singapore, or they're called something like that. They're called Malibu Towers or something like that, right? They are selling you a dream that you want, which is about consumption, about a consumption that is based in America, and we buy it, okay? And the child in Arunachal who also wants that laptop also has dreams of that Singapore home, right? When is it going to end? Because the planet is now not going to wait for too long. The extinction rates are unbearably high, and I think those are very, very conservative. So where is it? I mean, we are already breaking down in terms of, you know, we've lost time in terms of, you know, the crisis that we have. And now we are still going to, you know, while the fire is happening, you're still bickering on, I want a bigger pie, you had a bigger pie. You know, it's like a school debate.
I'll tell you one thing. I think, why the debate? There is no debate actually. The debate is that the debate is on the human consumption has dented the ecosystem. And who are these consumers? It's very natural to target at the largest consumer and the most, those consumers who have dented the most. My point only is that, you know, the consumptions where it is taking place is the one.
But Richard,
rather, the majority of people are having into a very sustainable consumptions. And the second question about aspiration, yes, we can't aspire to be an American as far as in devastating consumption is there. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about that the planet's poorest, the majority planets are already on a sustainable consumption basis, minus that 90% of the people, minus that 10% of the people. So the target of consumption fixation should be there. The second point is that those who are sustainable consumers must be formalized, factored in, and acknowledged, and their lifestyle must be acknowledged as the most ecosystem friendly.
I think both of you are sitting on a different spectrum. I think there is a middle ground, but you are still sticking with the ideology of what Indira Gandhi said, that poverty is the biggest polluter and we now need to protect that polluter in some sense. What Nitin is saying, that if you have equitable distribution of resources and the institutions and political systems that are aligned, which can make those distributions possible, then why not? And then we can have both climate mitigation and growth and consumption, and everybody is happy. But that is an utopian scenario, and I think yours is a broken system, which I don't think even holds true for India anymore. So my question, therefore, again, to the three of you is that, as looking at as planet, let's not focus on India. What I'm saying is, let's be a global citizen. You could be Icelandic, you could be a New Zealander. Why should they get caught? Or you could be in a small island nation. Why should they be caught in between the wars of the very large poor nations like India or China or the African nation, which groups together itself in COP25, versus the Americans, the Canadians, and the Western European? My only worry is that in this war, the only loser is going to be the entire world, while we are all fighting among ourselves. That's my question. So I'll go back to Nitin.
Can I just put a rejoinder? It means, 30 seconds. Irrespective of what Mrs. Gandhi said, pollution is the poverty is the biggest polluter. I think in case of developing, in context of India and developing countries, I think pollution is the biggest creator of poverty. I just want.
So, some factual corrections, and then I'll go back to the large theoretics. Globally, the small island countries actually vote along with Europe on everything, because most of the small island countries, half of them are actually on a per capita basis about 10 to 11 times richer than India on a per capita basis. Their economies are driven by European funding and tourism, etc., etc. They're locked into those societies. They don't do out of willingness, but they have no option because these big brothers control them. Similarly, China has a little circle of influence. US controls some countries. India tries to, but it's failingly to do it. Now, as a collective, when you come together at the UN, let me explain this UN process in 2 minutes, because I think we all get it really wrong. At the UN, it is an argument between nation states. It is not a situation where US tells what we do inside our country or we tell US what it does inside its country. By the simple logic that I did not vote for Mr. Trump, thankfully, and therefore I cannot hold him responsible to what he does inside his country. That is a fight that he has to fight with his citizens. Similarly, Mr. Modi, we have elected. That's a fight for us to fight domestically, to get more equity inside us as a society. At the UN forum, each nation has its unique history. Say Japan, extreme energy consumption, extremely efficient, stagflating, has a completely different logic than the rest of us. Much more efficient than all of us, yet is a high energy consumer. India, a long coastline with 700 million people at threatened by climate change physically. I'm not even talking about other problems. Has a bigger challenge than even perhaps a small island rich country which can migrate to New Zealand. Now, each of these countries is coming from their specific historical context. India with its colonial history, where a lot of our resources have been taken away. Other parts which are not. Africa, which is at the cusp of coming into this League of Nations. Some parts of Africa is, others are still behind. Now, each of them has absolute right to argue from their perspective. The only way this can be resolved is like a Gram Sabha, where everyone agrees that the road will be built in this way. The moment the smallest country says it cannot be done, it is never done in UN. So if you remember, the smallest country, Lucia and others, three countries, which are size of like a small locality here, said China, India will not do this and US will not do this, it did not happen. That's the power of that place, that once it agrees, everyone is on board and you move in that direction. it is actually more democratic than actually the kind of electoral politics we have in India. There's great strength in that. Short-circuiting that will lead us in the direction where India, China, and US can sit together tomorrow morning and decide the fate of the rest of the world. It's actually the only hope we have. Is it a slow process? Like all communities as families where we sit together and decide that everyone must agree, even if not entirely, but somewhat agree to what we're going to do, it always is a more productive and the right decision to take. Therefore, UN goes down this line. Now, on the second part of your question, which talks about consumption, etc., I don't think any one of us is disagreeing on where we need to go. Your job as a moderator is to obviously make us more entertaining. But I think all three of us are on board that we need to preserve nature in a certain fashion. We need to preserve our resources, if not nature, resources in a certain fashion. Cannot do the same thing that other nations have done. But what will enable us to do that? We don't have time, right? But if you look back, even in the colonial period, India did not have time when we went through these great famines because of colonialism. We lost timber at the rates that nobody else had. Europe got cleaned of its natural forests. Nobody talked of it then. Obviously, this emergency has existed for very long. It's not happened in the last 70 years. Neither is the decimation of nature happened in the last 40 years. It's happened since we were there, since industrialization began. Now, in that process, if you do not want us to do that, and I can promise you, no citizen in Arunachal wants to have a laptop and go to Singapore. They'll want to have a laptop and still sit in the middle of their nature and enjoy that life because that, they believe, is the core that keeps them together as who they are. Now, if we want to provide that, we have to provide additional resources for them to do that, to not cut their backyards down for us, not for themselves, for us. Most of the timber from Arunachal used to come to Delhi. Remember? So if you want to keep that space together for them and therefore for us, you have to empower them, provide them that which even we did not have as citizens. Provide them those resources that we used to burn things to produce for ourselves. Now, it will only get done, and this is not an economic argument, this is a moral argument. The moment you short-circuit morality and ethics, you might get a short-term solution where a Supreme Court comes in and bans one little project here, does that, eventually they also fall apart. I know she's itching, I'll come to you, sorry. But it's a short-circuit project, and it eventually fails. We've seen this across the globe, this notion that you can actually sequester people away and short-circuit their rights, and in the short term save the things, it will fail eventually.
While I agree with lot of what you have said, definitely on consumption and but you know, there is not one solution for everything, and like any society, unfortunately, even the most democratic or the at the most grassroots level, you have different people. I'll give there are many examples, but if there is a protest and for say a thermal power plant, which was in this case in Sindhudurg in Maharashtra, the people were fighting against it. But within the people, there are divisions because for your land, you get money. And one brother will want that money and the other brother will want that land. And it has created mayhem. So I would say that we, and I would not say that we have failed as in conservation, which Nitin says. We have not failed. We have tigers and elephants and great Indian bustards and floricans and leopards and dolphins, which most of the world don't have, the countries we aspire to become. Where have we failed? We are failing, yes, but we have so much. And why? One, the people. The tolerance, the acceptance, the reverence that people have is remarkable, unmatched. And I'm 100% with Nitin over here. But it's not alone. It has to also come from law. And the legal framework is why we have this so much percent of land protected. And there are places which will need to be sacrosanct. There is no getting away from it. Unless we, so to me, it has to be a complex set of, factors. It's never one factor. And I will include one more thing, compassion. You know, think with compassion. Think, put yourself in other people's shoes. Even others think like a species, you know. Imagine how what And that, I think, will also...
Sir, sir, go for interaction.
I think first, the bottom line is that you must acknowledge the traditional sustainable consumption lifestyles that's already alive and thriving. Keep that aside. Bring them into the mainstream discussions. And the second part is that the over-consumptions. The Americans' variety, both in America and in India, must also be put under scrutiny. Yeah.
Individual choices which will save the planet. It's hard political decisions, and we as citizens need to get more involved in politics and governance.
All those things are important. Politics trumping economics, economics trumping science. And I think it happens in reverse cycles in different regimes, whether a democracy acknowledges science or not. I think those are the kind of quandaries that we will have. But all of us agree that equity needs to be within the paradigm of saving the planet. Compassion for conservation of all varieties of life is important. Safeguarding traditional knowledge is a very, very important factor, something that we are very readily happy to relinquish in our lifetimes. And I think that's something that is very, very critical. And I think I'm going to now open up for three questions, or maybe four. I'm going to ask the gentleman there with the, please stand up. Yeah, the question to you. The young girl here in front. Yeah, 1 second. Two of them first, please. Gentleman there, please. Sorry. Please keep your question. You know, just keep your question, not a comment, please.
Recently, the countries of Arctic Council said that they are trying to benefit the ice melting and global warming. And they're justifying by saying that it is due to their population explosion. One thing. And second thing, how can we relate the ushering of populist pro-capitalist politics and also the boom in population with regard to this context?
Okay. That's a question for Nitin and Richard, and I think I'll let them answer it a little later. The young lady in front here, the one with the blues. Yeah, the young lady, yes, please.
So whatever method we use, it's obvious that all of us have to work on it together.
Yes.
So, like, we've all heard about, like, Australia being on fire and the Amazon being on
fire. What's your question?
And we all hear it on social media. We see it for a second, and we're all, like, sad about it. And out of sight, out of mind, right? After we see it, we post a story, everyone forgets about it. My question is that morality that we forget about it? Is it a question of how humanity is, or is it a question of how information is produced and consumed, and how can we change that? How can we keep that, the sense of we should protect environment, how can we keep it in mind always?
Okay,
because we should.
And the third question to the gentleman who was standing first, the one behind you. So three questions. Nitin, this is for you, and again, Richard.
This is to Bindra, madam. Sir, you mentioned that when vultures vanish, nature's scavengers are vanishing. This is on the economics of ecology, ecological valuation. Recently, in a TOI report, it said that Indian tiger is more precious than the Taj Mahal. So what is the value of a vulture, a tiger, a dolphin?
Okay.
The ecological valuation.
I think that's a good question. And the young boy in front, please. Yes. Yeah. Okay, question.
So why does India not introduce like carbon sequestration methods? Like, please don't tell that it's just the funds, because India has the money to build statues, etc., etc.
Yes, you have. You asked this question yesterday, so I'm going to ask Nitin to answer question. No, let's. We've got 4 minutes. So.
It's okay. Time
okay,
over.
Okay, come on.
Time is over.
Okay, just one quick question, please. Be very quick.
Hello, hi, hi, beautiful souls. She talking about the scenes about the nations, but she forget that only one thing. PLUR, peace, love, unity, respect.
Okay, that's what.
That's what I say. I want to say for nations, for India, whatever.
Okay.
For state of mind, just everyone forget. Okay. State of mind.
Thank you. That's a good point.
And you are the very good point. She shared that. Very nice. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for the opportunity.
So, to answer to the young gentleman, it's not a question of whether we have enough money or not. When you talk about sequestering carbon, what you're doing is you are again disrupting nature. You are actually burying chemicals inside soils. You're altering weather patterns. Geoengineering in itself is a challenge of how do you play with nature yet again. And when you use geoengineering, what you're actually doing is you're giving a license to people who consume more to continue consuming. Because you say, you can keep on consuming, I'll keep on burying it. I'll grow forest on my land, you keep on running your private cars as much as you want. So the question is not actually of sequestering, but actually saying, can we reduce your use of fossil fuels? Can you reduce the emissions in the first place? Those who consume more. And that will give space to those who consume less in Africa, not even in India now, to actually consume a little more, have a little industry, grow more jobs, get better off than they are today. So sequestering is a more political question of letting somebody off the hook rather than a question of economics.
On the value of a tiger, etc., the price, yes, there have been calculations, there are attempts to say Kanha Tiger Reserve is worth so much because it gives employment to so much through tourism, because it sequesters so much carbon, because of the watershed, etc., etc. So there, in that sense, it has been calculated to have more value than the Taj Mahal. Having said that, there are intrinsic values, values of nature that you cannot calculate. What is the joy that you see? Why do you come to the beach? So I will end there. That's the priceless with the young lady who asked about how do you stay engaged? Why do you disassociate if 2 minutes later? My instinct is to delve more if it is interesting me. Find out more. Find out what's happening to the local ecology around you. Find out, are there natural parks around? Is there a movement to save a lake somewhere? Get involved. Read more. And you have, you know, everything at your fingertips. And do not expect that it is only the job of the environmentalist. You are as impacted by everything. And the moment you start reading, getting interested, drawing the links, you will know how empowered you are. All of us just started as, you know, they're like you.
Okay. To end, I think your question about Arctic melting, that's the geopolitics. I think that's one sign that why certain countries, certain people are cheering about the worst impact of global warming, that new geography will open up, we'll get more minerals, more oil, rare minerals, and the economy will boom and we'll profit out of it. So remember, that's why we have the climate change deniers also. So I don't have a comment on this except that this is not something to cheer about it. That shows our state of fighting against climate emergency also. Conjunctions, we don't want to negotiate anyway. I think that's the bottom line.
I think we must bring the session to close. Thank you, Nitin. Thank you, Prerna. Thank you, Richard. I think we don't have a single solution. I think there is a series of political and economic and ecological methods that we need, and some of these need to be customized to local conditions. I think we need to understand communities, and not just biological ones, but also human communities that live among those biological communities. Thank you so much for being such a patient audience, and see you in the next session on Western Ghats and the fragile economy of the Western Ghats.
Thank you, sir. Give it.